I'll try to join the dots, basically give you a holistic picture of what the threat is, possible mitigations, what is the landscape currently, what is the research work happening in this area, a little peek of what we are doing at Isilon to mitigate this. So, okay, I'll do a page down, this will work. So first point, sorry about the font, it's full screen is going out of bounds, so I have to present it in this fashion. So why this topic? Is it because there's a buzz going around about ransomware? Actually, I submitted this topic more than a month back. The WannaCry virus malware or ransomware. I'll be using malware and ransomware interchangeably because they are one and the same thing, actually. So the WannaCry had hit on the 15th of this month. So my presentation was put up much before that. And that explains, we consider this as a serious threat. At Isilon, Isilon is a NAS product, network attached storage. We were aware, we were working towards a solution. It just so happened that this gave us an extra visibility, so to speak. Who am I? I am a principal software engineer with Isilon. I have, why should you attend this session? I have a lineage of working with companies like Nevis Networks, that was into deep packet inspection. I have worked with LSI, I have worked with Veritas for secure application and storage. And currently I'm working with Dell EMC on the Isilon product. Yeah. Disclaimer, I had much bigger set of slides. It went to legal, it got pruned massively. Okay. All approaches that we are currently working on have been removed from the slide. These are not Dell views. Whatever I'm presenting in the slides today are completely what I feel is the way to go. Okay? So, wait. So, just a, I'm not a salesperson, it's not a sales pitch, but many references which I'll give will be vis-a-vis our product. Okay? So, I have to give you a background of what Isilon is. It's a NAS box. It's a clustered device. You can add nodes. It's a scale-out architecture. Basically, you add another node and you increase the performance, you increase the storage, right? That's what scale-out is. We have a single file system, a single volume. We have a single namespace. A couple of friends sitting here from a competitor product, they claim to be a single file system, single namespace. They are not. We are actually a single file system. And it's based out of FreeBSD. It's called OneFS, right? We have, so there's something called role-based access control. This is not something unique to Isilon. All products will have some kind of role-based access control. I put this here in this slide. I'll come back to this after I explain another part of how to mitigate ransomware. But you'll get a clue, right? I'll come back to role-based access control later. Right. So what is the agenda of today's talk? First, I'll be quickly introducing what is a ransomware. Again, malware slash ransomware because they are one and the same. There are different types of ransomware. So just to get a complete understanding, we'll just look at the types of ransomware. We'll look at the top ransomwares in the wild right now. And we'll specifically focus on one ransomware. I was going to actually look at CryptoLock. But since WannaCry is there, it's ongoing right now, we'll look at that. We'll look at a few attacks so that you get more interested in the topic, right? Some famous attacks that happened, some that you might not know, most of it you may already know. Then I will talk about how to protect yourself from ransomware. So there are multiple approaches, there are antivirus vendors. So malware falls under antivirus category. So antivirus vendors have come up with solutions, their best practices, right? I will explain what are the best practices, what are the vendors saying, what are the solutions they are providing. Along with that, I'll also look at some research papers in this area. And once you've looked at all this, you would realize that they are working on the same couple of methods in which you can solve this problem, right? They're, be it a research area, be it an antivirus vendor, or there are many vendors in the market, say Symantec or FireEye, many vendors, but they are all working on the same couple of ways to solve this problem, right? At the end, I'll conclude with my prediction, and again, it's not Dell, it's my prediction of what I feel this space is going to go to in future. Okay? Yes. So, you all know what is a ransomware. You all know what is a ransomware. Just that I want to give a flow of how actually the ransomware works. Once you are clear with the flow, you can actually distinguish between different kinds of ransomware in the wild, right? A ransomware is a malware. It gets installed in the system and does something like encryption or locking your system. And then you have to pay a ransom to actually get your system back. Now, what are the typical steps that a ransomware will follow? The typical steps are, first, it will have to find a vulnerability on your system. It can be a Windows system, it can be a Unix system, right? It finds a vulnerability on the system, it exploits the vulnerability. After exploiting the vulnerability, it will install a payload. That payload will then, if it is, so there are types of ransomware. If it is an encryption type of ransomware, that ransomware will then talk to a server remotely, a command and control server, generate a key pair, get the key locally, the public key locally, encrypt the data, and then ask for a ransom. Delete the public key also locally. Okay? So exploit a vulnerable application, download the payload. This is called an attack vector. I'll explain further slides what is attack vector. Attacker gets command and control of the compromised system. This is not command and control which I was talking about. This is a generic term. Now, this allows for privilege escalation. So what is privilege escalation? I'll explain in detail later. And this is another possible mitigation to this problem. Okay? Any doubts, you can stop me in between. Any questions, right? Yes. Oh, okay. So, right. Exploit a vulnerable application. How do you know what vulnerabilities are there in an application? Right? We ourselves have done the task very simple. There's a universal database. It's called CVE database, Common Vulnerability and Exposures. If you're not aware of CVE, developers or organizations looking at products, trying to find out vulnerabilities in the product, when they find a vulnerability, they report the vulnerability and it gets registered in a common database called a CVE database. There are multiple US agencies or European agencies that maintain the database, but basically you get a number, a CVE number, right? Be it Microsoft product, be it a Unix product, be it proprietary products. There are CVEs opened against even Isilon, okay? So you get a CVE, and from that CVE basically explains what the vulnerability is. Any attacker can look at the list of CVEs and then launch an attack against a product which is having that version of application installed. I'll give an example also of what I mean by that. So how does a CVE look like? Okay, so this is what a CVE looks like, right? This is CVEdetails.com is from where I picked up this CVE, right? And this CVE, I guess, is specific to, this is actually specific to the WannaCry malware. So basically, it tells you multiple things. It gives a CVE ID. If you look at the CVE ID, it's CVE hyphen, so this is the constant, 2017, which year it was identified, and a unique number for that CVE, 0238. It gives a vulnerability type, it gives a score, and then gives other details. So what is the score? Each CVE has a CVSS score. The score basically says how severe the vulnerability is, right? So you have from scale 0 to 10, 10 being the maximum, right? So this is a pretty severe vulnerability. There are open source tools available. Have you heard of Metasploit? Right? So there are open source tools available by which you can just look at these CVEs. You know, okay, there is a vulnerability in Windows, this version. Take Metasploit, attack a Windows machine, and actually exploit that vulnerability. It's that easy. Okay, so that is what attackers do. They normally keep looking up for new CVEs that come up. They have tools, ready-made tools. They don't have to be really brilliant. They have these tools available. They just attack a system and try to get access to the system and then exploit the system. That is what they do. Okay, any questions, doubts so far? Right. So,
What is an attack vector?
An attack vector is a path through which an attacker gets access to the system, right? So I said you have to exploit a vulnerability and then you'll inject a malware, right? To exploit the vulnerability, you have to actually engage the user in either clicking on some mail attachment or maybe downloading something from a site which has a Trojan in it or malware in it, right? Common attack vector. So attack vector is basically how the attacker is going to access the system first, after which it injects the payload, right? So what are the possible common attack vectors? The common attack vectors are email, instant messages, the email attachments, web pages, pop-up windows, right? You go to a site, it pops up a window saying, click here to get a prize or something, right? Or you get an email saying, your financial records have a problem, click here, and you just click and you don't realize you're actually installing an application, right? So these are the common attack vectors. And knowing this is important because this is the way the ransomware actually enters into a system. Once you understand this, right, when I tell you about possible ways to mitigate or solve the problem, you'll get an idea, the correlation between this and the possible ways. Looking at this, you'd yourself immediately realize the first stage to stop the ransomware is to take care of this, right? Educate your users, make sure they don't click on pop-ups or just because there's mails with an attachment, don't open it unless you know it's from a trusted source, right? Things like that. This is clear, right? Yeah. So what are the types of ransomwares? There is two broad categories of ransomware, okay? I have added, so if you see, I said there are two types of ransomware and then I've added another note at the bottom. Yeah.
So how do they know this vulnerability? So they write some malware?
They don't have to do anything. That's the best part. We tell them the vulnerabilities. So I'm a developer. I'm using, say, Firefox. I realize if I do so XYZ sequence of things, then there is a possibility that the browser might crash. I open that as a bug, which is called a CVE, and that gets registered on that common website. So there's mitra.com, there is a US website for CVEs, the CVE details is another website. It's a common database. Anybody can look up that database. Anybody can look up. Just go to that cvdetails.com, search for Microsoft Firefox or Internet Explorer, and you'll get all the vulnerabilities against that browser. You don't have to do anything. It's that simple. Sitting in this room, I know there is a person using a laptop at the back. I will first scan and find out what operating system he is using. That you can easily find out. Okay? There are tools available to find out what operating system a particular IP has. Once you know the operating system, just go to CVE database, find out all vulnerabilities against the operating system. Then use, there are tools available, like I mentioned earlier. Use the tool, launch an attack against the machine. You don't have to do anything. It happens automatically, right? Yeah. That's why it's scary. That's why this topic, and that's why we are working on this, right? Huh. So basically, there are two types of malwares, which I classify them in these two types. One is in a locker malware and a encryption malware. So certain kinds of ransomware will actually lock the system. They will deny you access to the system till you pay a ransom, right? Recently, there was an attack on the German railway system and they had locked the German railway system out of the controls. And they said, pay a ransom and then we'll give you access to the machine, right? So that is one category of ransomware. The second category of ransomware is where it encrypts your data and it says, pay a certain amount and we'll give you the decryption key so that you can get your data back. Right? People have been paying. There are reports of some police department in the US having paid. I have a letter in the slides where one of the hospitals had paid the ransom and they had given a letter to all its shareholders saying this is why we had to pay the ransom. Right? There are stories wherein people have paid the ransom but they have not got access to the data back. Right? So things like that have also happened. Okay? So why this other category? Okay, there are multiple threads that I'm trying to explain. So please, right? This is another category of malware that don't sit on the disk as a file. They sit in the memory and they do encryption or whatever they are doing through memory. Now, why this is relevant? How do antivirus detect ransomware? I'll get to this slide later, but one of the methods they use is signature analysis. So are you aware of signature analysis? Right? Every virus file would have some kind of MD5 hash. That signature database is published online, right? There is an understanding between antivirus vendors. They share their databases with each other. If I am Symantec today, I find a new virus, I'll come up with a signature for it, update my antivirus definitions for my customers, and then pass this information to McAfee at the back. This is a back channel. When I was in Nevis, I used to actually get information from this back channel because I have worked on this signature analysis before. So everyone has the signature database. The signature database is even published openly, right? But this works on files which are on disk. So there's a malware which is in the form of a file. It is sitting on your disk. The antivirus will scan the file, say, hey, there is a match. The MD5 hash of this file is matching from a common malware signature that is put online. This is a malware. If it is running from memory, you'll not be able to catch it, right? So it's a cat and mouse game, right? You analyze the malware, that is what researchers do. They analyze the malware, they find, okay, this is what it is doing, so let's do these preventive steps. The malware writers change it a little more, they modify, they go to the next step. An example, the WannaCry virus, its spread stopped a little because it was looking for a particular domain. Somebody went and registered the domain. I'm going to explain that in detail later. So the virus is now not, it installs, but is not activated. It does not go and encrypt files. But tomorrow, if the virus writers sell it in the black market, it's called the dark web, right? Somebody picks up, just changes that part wherein it goes and looks at a domain, changes that part, you have a new version of malware sitting, right? So it will not look at the domain. You can't have that way of stopping the malware from spreading, right? Small modifications and you have a new type of malware available. So that's why I call it a cat and mouse game. Okay, so that is why this part was important that I added here. Okay, I'm doing on time, yes. Okay, so these top malwares that I've listed out, I got this list from Tripwire. Tripwire is another good security product. I'm not from Tripwire, I'm from Isilon, but I use Tripwire, so I've just kind of put that information here. I put WannaCry at the top, it's not at the top. CryptoWall is actually at top, but I'm putting WannaCry at top because it is very recent and we have seen lots of issues at the UK hospital system, or be it in the German train system and other places. So that is why I've kept it on top right now. And this is what I'll explain in detail. Right. So this information, I just picked it up from the web and I put in the slides, but I'll explain what it does actually. So what do these type of malwares do? I'm talking mostly about encryption malwares. I'm not talking about the locking kind of malwares that actually lock your system and deny you access of the system, okay? So what these malwares do is, they'll install on the system, they'll encrypt all your files, they'll give a extension to your file, a new extension. So I guess this uses WCRY extension to your files. And then it deletes the original file. Another way, so what you would do is, as a developer, you would think, okay, there is a pattern here. Right? You read a file, you encrypt and save it as a new file, delete the file. So what they started doing, they opened the same file and encrypt and write to the same file. Okay? So this is the second pattern. So you write some signature against that pattern. Right? Then they do a third thing. So that is why this will continue. My prediction is not going to end in the near future, but there is a way in which we can end this, is what I am going to suggest at the end. So what does it do? Yes, there is a good story behind this. NSA has a set of tools, right? You've heard of NSA tools being released in the public by some hackers. NSA has a set of hacking tools, right? They use it to attack other governments, other companies. Say if they want to bring down Iran's nuclear program, they would attack the nuclear reactors with a particular kind of virus. They have done that in 1980s. They had actually attacked the Iranian nuclear reactors with a particular Trojan. Now they want to attack a rogue nation. Iran was just an example. If they want to attack a rogue nation, they will actually run some kind of malware or some kind of attack against that particular nation's infrastructure, right? They had developed a set of tools, okay? That tool was called, I'll have to go to the next slide. That tool was called Eternal Blue, right? So a group of hackers called Shadow Brokers actually broke into their system, stole those tools, and released them in the wild, okay? The WannaCry malware was created looking at these tools, right? So Eternal Blue was the tool to exploit. It was written by NSA, and the attackers stole it from NSA, released it in the wild. A group of attackers picked up that information and they said, hey, this looks interesting. I can actually exploit a Windows system using this so-and-so vulnerability that has not been reported so far, right? They took that vulnerability, they created a malware. They launched a malware. At the same time, Windows actually released a patch. But see the problem, patches are released, people don't apply it religiously. You would get the prompt saying, even I don't apply it by the way, you get the prompt saying reboot required to apply the prompts at times. I don't apply it, right? Because multiple tabs are open even right now. People don't apply it, and then this ransomware gets installed in your system. Imagine this whole thing was avoidable only if you had patched the system on time, okay? So, right, this is widely believed to be a tool developed by the NSA. This line basically, so how does it get installed? How does this vulnerability payload gets delivered to the user? It tricks the user into opening an email, click on an attachment, right? It'll say it's your tax invoice or some urgent renewal required, some Excel file, something. When you actually open it, it's actually a Trojan that gets installed in your system, right? You might be aware of, I don't know the exact details, but there were some Indians operating from Thane who used to actually call in the US and they used to tell folks there that we are from the IRA, Income Tax Authority. IRS, yes. They used to make calls there, say, oh, 10 minutes, saying that you are from the IRS and if you don't enter so-and-so detail, right, we are going to tax you heavily or something of that sort. They had access to the database, the IRS database. And the victims are made to pay money to the Indian sitting here in Thane. It was a big scam, right? So you can force people to open such attachments or actually install such malwares. This is not going to stop. This is going to happen. This is again one of my predictions, right? This is never going to stop. You cannot educate all the users to be careful, right? So that is the second thing that I'm saying. So data gets encrypted, it adds an extension, and it deletes the original data, okay? I have 10 minutes, so I have to rush because the main part is at the end. So this I've already explained. It has a SMBv2 vulnerability that it exploits. And so this, by the way, the vulnerability allows remote code execution. This explanation I have got from the CVE website. So you wanted to know how I can get that information. I just logged into the website. I said Microsoft vulnerabilities. This was the first one I got. And this is the explanation. And at times they even give scripts to actually test whether you are susceptible to that vulnerability or not. Use that script and you know how to attack the system, right? So, right. Now, unpatched Windows computers exposing the SMB services can be remotely attacked. So I have explained so far that there is an attack vector. They compromise your system, they install a malware. Now, how is the key exchange done, right? You generate a public-private key on the system. Then you export this private key onto a remote server. Now this is the interesting part. If an attacker here is giving me the private key, right, the authorities can find out who this person is shipping the key to. So how does the attacker avoid the authorities from finding out where the key is going? They use the Tor network. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing it correctly, but there's a Tor network, right? It's basically it was developed by the US Navy itself, and it's a network of switches and routers through which if you want to access a site, even the US government is not able to find out the source of that request, okay? So the malware has a list of servers that will try to connect to, and the private key it will send to that site, right? You have, if the authorities can find out where the private key is going to, they can bring down that server. But they can't because it is going over the Tor network. They have found out ways now to actually trace users, but it's not absolutely foolproof. Okay, so here you can be invisible. You use this network. For example, people in China. I was working on a product in Nevis Networks that could let governments block websites at line speed. So at 10 Gbps traffic, it could actually look deep inside the packet and drop packets or allow packets, right? So if you are in such a regime where they're blocking your traffic, they're filtering your traffic, go via the Tor network. That is what people normally used to do. Now this is used by attackers to actually ship the private key onto a remote server, right? Yes, so command and control, this is done, okay. So, right. So this is what it normally looks like. This is what pops up after your system has been encrypted. You must have seen it 1,000 times, but I've still displayed it for end-to-end understanding of the case. This is what popped up on the display boards on the German railway system, once their systems are compromised by the WannaCry malware, okay? Now, how has it stopped spreading right now? The kill switch, right? What is a kill switch? Basically, a malware will actually try to look up a domain. If it finds the domain, it will not encrypt the files on the system. That's called a kill switch, basically kill the malware. And the attackers themselves put a kill switch, right? Why do you think an attacker would have put a kill switch in this? The attacker definitely wanted to infect as many machines that it could. Why did it put a kill switch in this? Any guesses? So they actually put a kill switch because how do you analyze a malware? You analyze a malware or a ransomware by installing it in a virtual environment. You install it in a virtual environment, see how it behaves. On the basis of its behavioral patterns, you come up with signatures or machine learning steps. Okay, the malware will do this first, will connect here, and if this and this are there, then it's a XYZ ransomware, right? So what the malware does is, it realizes it's in a virtual environment. How does it realize it's in a virtual environment? It'll try to connect to a non-existing domain. The domain does not exist. The moment it realizes, the moment the virtual environment realizes it's trying to connect outside, it fakes that domain and sends a response. The malware realizes, oh, the domain is not there, but I'm getting a response. Means I'm in a virtual environment. So that's where the kill switch. The kill switch actually helped in stopping the spread because someone wanted to see what kind of traffic is going on. That person actually registered the domain. And that is why all the new installations of the malware realized, oh, the kill switch has been activated. We are not supposed to encrypt files. Systems which are already encrypted, sorry, you can't do anything about that, right? So, quickly, top attacks. I'll actually skip this part because the important part is next. So this is the letter that I was talking about. You will see it in the slides later where this, I guess the CTO has released a letter saying why we had to give the amount. They actually went ahead and paid the amount to the attackers, right? Now that we are here, how do antivirus detect ransomware? They used to, I've already explained this, they use signatures and they use some behavioral patterns. Behavioral patterns means how the malware is actually accessing the files on the system, right? How it is deleting files, how it is actually contacting the command and control server to ship the private key, stuff like that, right? Now, if you look at signatures, they are helpful only to a certain extent. They are helpful for known malware strains, which are already known, people have analyzed them. But for zero-day attacks, behavioral is the key. So there are many vendors that give the behavioral version of antivirus that actually looks at behavior and says, I think this is a ransomware. But ransomwares have become smarter. They have realized how antivirus actually figure out and they just change the code a little to have a new strain of malware in the system. Encryption mechanism, I'll skip right now, right? Any doubts on this? If you could just read the slide, right? This is the crux actually. This is what most new antivirus vendors, most antivirus vendors are kind of advertising newly. We do this, right? On the basis of this, we'll be able to stop the WannaCry ransomware or other ransomwares. Yeah, heuristics. Yes, absolutely. How do you protect, right? Now, okay. It's a never-ending thing. You have, yeah. Even if it was a Unix system, and you know that the Unix system, the shell, has a vulnerability. With that vulnerability, you can exploit it and have privilege elevation. Privilege elevation means you actually entered into the system using a normal user, but you could elevate yourself to root user. Then you can go ahead and encrypt the files on that system also. The attack is seen commonly against a Windows system, but ransomwares attack Unix systems also. They're not specific to an operating system. The signature is common, yes. I can't say for any operating system. There might be differences because the way it scans a Unix system would be different from the way it scans a Windows system. So signatures would, I think, would be different, right? So educate the user. Educate the user not to actually go and click on random attachments unless he or she is sure it's coming from a trusted source. Don't go to websites that pop up things, and unless you are sure, don't click on those sites. Plan for the possibility. This is the key. You have to actually have a fire drill. You have to think that your system is going to get attacked. You have to start thinking that your data is going to get compromised. Plan for that. And it's not a DR exercise. Why it is not a DR exercise, I'll tell you in the next slide. DR exercise is disaster recovery. If this site goes down, I'll come up from that site, right? So you think I have a DR solution, fine, I'm safe. It's not that case. Patch all your systems regularly. I've already said that. Everything runs as root. This is the most important part. You would see products, go back, look at your products. You would see many processes are running as root when they don't have to. If such a process gets compromised, it gets root privileges to any attacker. So check all your processes in your system that are running as root. See if they actually have to run as root or not. Okay? Firewalls. I said in the command and control, it goes actually to the Tor network and gives the key back. You can actually block known accesses to such networks. And firewalls do that. Most companies do that. Antivirus signatures and machine learning is another way to protect. But they are best practices, right? Check permissions. There are certain files that can be read-only, right? Yeah, just 1 minute. Certain files, it can be read-only. You don't have to give them read-write permissions so that an attacker can come and encrypt that file. Look at such permissions. Review access controls. Does every user that is logging into the system need a root access? If it doesn't, if he or she does not need a root access and can work with a normal access, give them normal access. Tomorrow, if a malware comes via them, so the key is NAS systems are also susceptible to these attacks. I, as a user, have mounted a folder, a partition or whatever from the NAS box. I get exposed to malware, and that malware goes and encrypts the data in that share. If I was root, everything would get encrypted. So check for permissions. Don't give administrative privileges when not needed. I think this is the last slide of that. Right. How to protect? Backup regularly. But is backup sufficient? I started late, so I have a couple of minutes more. Okay. So there was a discussion going on yesterday between some folks in the other room saying we backup, we give 30 minutes period to actually things to settle down. Now malwares have become even smarter. What they do is they incrementally encrypt files. So today they'll encrypt one file, next five files over the next day and so on and so forth. Your backup is getting encrypted incrementally. A couple of file changes you would not realize. You have millions of files. A couple of file changes you not realize. After a month, you'll realize all your files in the backup are encrypted, right? So backup is not enough, right? There is a solution here which I can't talk about, but there are ways to look at this also. My prediction, I'll close with this. My prediction is this is not going to stop. There'll be new malwares, there'll be new attacks. But what will happen is somebody would come up with a solution that will ensure very easy and convenient backups and safe backups. So tomorrow you get infected by a malware, you click a button, you get a new system. It's like getting a new virtual machine. Then the attacker has no monetary benefits. So the attacker will slowly, after a period of time, this thing will wane out, is my take on this, right? Research papers, so I've attached information about a couple of research papers. This paper explains, it has done research of more than some 5 or 10,000 known strains of malwares. And it has come up with analysis of how these malware actually operate on file level or encryption or so on and so forth. This is interesting because this is very interesting paper. I can't explain in detail right now, but what it basically does is anytime a key is used for encryption, it keeps the copy of the key with itself. So you can actually use that key to decrypt, right? But this is a theoretical thing right now. It's not actually being used in operating systems currently, right? Last part. This dynamically analyzes ransomware, it actually creates a virtual environment on the system, let the malware get into the virtual environment, see its behavior, and accordingly apply rules on the fly. So this is another research work that is going on. But if you realize, they're all playing in the same space, right? They know, okay, there is a pattern, let's try to get the pattern and block the pattern, is what they're trying to do, okay? I say patterns will keep on changing. This is another one, but I'll skip here. So any questions? I'm done. I rushed in the end, but any questions? Right? So I'm done. So the common narrative is, yes. Yes.
So what if we block SSL from our system?
So, but what happens to other applications? And then I will I'll connect to the command and control, get private and public keys from there instead of generating it locally. Right? And some malwares don't use, so then you can block APIs. You can put hooks in the API. If you see a pattern that multiple files are getting encrypted, you'll block the API itself. So encryption will not happen. But then malwares put the encryption algorithm in themselves itself. They don't use the API. So one of the papers talks about blocking the Windows API when it realizes there's a pattern happening. But then the malware would be smart. It'll activate its own encryption algorithm so that it doesn't need the local APIs. Right? Right, right. So then in that case, if I am a malware writer, I'll write a very small malware that takes care, uses the API. If I realize it's blocked, I'll use command and control, connect to the remote server, and download that API to do encryption. So I'll be lean initially, but then when I realize I'm getting blocked, I'll go and get the API for encryption. Right, yes. So you can do those things. So that's why I said it's a cat and mouse game. There is no silver bullet. You do this and it stops. It's not that way. Right? Any questions?
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you.